12 light plates on a heating blanket, which controls between 36 to 37 degrees. We seed the carcinoma cell lines to get an even monolayer maybe 48 hours before. Each cell line that we're starting to work with is slightly different in what it needs to give a good coating that you can actually fill. And then the macrophages are stimulated with 100 nanograms per mil 3 days prior. So we have a little bit of combination of cell culture work to get going to get it in. And at the minute, I favour a 12-well plate. This is the setup. You can see the standard microscope. There's the heating blanket, which works very well. And then we've got a digital camera through the eyepiece. There are a couple of issues. One of the issues, condensation happens during the process of the culture. We don't really get too much evaporation in that. We start off with a 4 mil fill volume, which lasts us for 10 days quite easily. And sometimes I'm trying to clear the condensation, there's a slight movement of the plate, and the condensation can make the filming actually go out of focus. Just to give you an idea of what the cultures you're looking at, this is a typical breast carcinoma cell monolayer. You can see the ball of cells here, which actually sits above the monolayer, so it comes up and rises up, so you have like a 3D structure above. And I'd like to point out to you that here, this is the raw. This is a typical culture of raw macrophage culture. It's semi-adherent, so they do culture in suspension, but if they can attach, they like to do so. And it's to give you some idea of the differences of the two cell lines when we go on to the actual videos. So the first one is MCF7 plus GcMAF activated raws. Some of these I've speeded up because you'll see. Here we go. There's the ball of cells that you can see at the bottom. The macrophages come in. They start to form clusters, which is very interesting to listen to Professor Ryan's talk, because I wondered why they kind of gathered, and some of the explanation might be there in that respect. You can see that they're searching around for the actual cells themselves. They're collecting along this part of the clusters of MCF7 cells. They're moving around. We have seen cells which put out protrusions. They don't seem to move, they just put out protrusions, which again has been explained, and there's some that seek out and destroy the cells. So this is, we see this regularly. This is kind of a routine assay for us. We see this week in, week out with every batch. You can see that the clusters of macrophages move around quite succinctly. They're pretty quick in what they do. If you ever thought that your cell cultures were static, then think again. See the continuation of the monolayer. I mean, most of the cells that you can actually see moving now are raw cells, but if you focus in on here, you'll see the actual monolayer start to disappear. It takes, you see the monolayer actually clearing now off the plate. Macrophages also, the number that we put in, there always seems to be more afterwards, and it's hard to get a cell count post in that respect. But we do try, but it's really hard to distinguish between them. The ball of cells at the bottom that we were looking at is almost completely gone now. It just seems to be a focus of necrotic cells pulling in, the monolayers kind of disappearing. It happens about 5 to 7 days, sometimes up to 10, 170 hours, about 8 days, which is equal to this. You can see them all pulling apart now. This is the cell line MM127, so it gives you an idea that they are different. The MCS7s is a really strong individual monolayer. This is a little bit more different, and you can see that it's they've got protrusions and they're slightly different, and we're beginning to learn that these are things that we're doing. So we're looking at MM127s now with the human macrophages 9853. To give you an idea, this is I've graded this out because it's easier to see the cells on the monolayer. And this is a T0, so you can see the 9853 cells are already beginning to cluster as they go in. We try and disperse them for a cell count, but they tend to prefer to grow quite differently to the raws in that respect. But it gives you an idea of where the actual tumor cells are. I've speeded this one up, so it gives you the same sort of principle. You'll see that go very rapidly when the clusters go, and I've got it slowed up so you can see a little bit more as it goes through. Again, this is a one frame every 3 minutes, so it shows you that the cell cultures are very active, really. You can see the actual tumour cells starting to be less protrusions, and I'd like to show you this now. If you just look at this down here, as this goes through the actual monolayer, it just devours everything in sight and leaves it almost clear. Just clears it like that. And I'd like to focus on this cell here, because this is one that's moved out of a couple there. If you follow that on, you'll just see that get picked up by some macrophages and gone. I haven't found anywhere that's done human carcinoma cell lines at all, MM127 being a melanoma with human macrophages. We've only ever seen with the raw, so that's a first for us in that respect. So macrophages, as you know, as has been explained, they should seek out and destroy anything that's foreign in the body. If they did that routinely, then cancers wouldn't actually progress. So this is some of the controls that we're after are looking at non-activated cells and also the actual precursor, the GC globulin activated cells. So this is another video of MCF7. You've seen the first one with non-activated 9853s. So this is... So here come the 9853s. You'll see they come and try and form clusters. And it's interesting to focus on this area where there's one of those clumps of cells above, with MCF7s above the monolayer. You can see that they're all moving around. The time frame is very similar to the first video that we've seen. And you can see that whilst they're sat on top of the tumor cells, it just seems to progress. Nothing's really getting cleared in the time frame at all. The MCF7 cells just seem to be progressing in terms of their culture. And you can see that this mass now is just getting larger. So 9853, the previous one, we've seen them actually form clusters and clear the monolayer. In this, where they're non-activated, you don't see any of that. And in fact, the MCF7 culture is just getting bigger. What they're sat around is the 9853s, and this is the MCF7 cells. So even though they're supposed to seek out and phagocytize cells which are foreign, it's not actually happening in our hands in this world. Coupled with that, what we also try and do is take snapshots at time. So we set up little cultures in the same time frame, and then we do some eosine staining on it. So we've seen some of these stains which are typical. So this is MCF7 with 9853. And you can see is the MCF7s. The 9853s are actually ingressing in, which Professor Ruggiero mentioned earlier today, where you see this halo effect of cells coming into the cytoplasm, and you can see it on numerous occasions. I mean, this is after 72 hours, so you can see that the cytoplasm and a lot of the cells are actually being disrupted quite effectively by the sort of 9853 cells. And again, this is human breast carcinoma with human macrophages. It's quite effective, really. To give you an idea of the difference of the cultures, this is MM127, which is the human melanoma cell, again with the 9853 after 72 hours. And you can see that the 9853s are in clusters, which is how they acted when you saw that ball move across the video screen. You can see here, this is cytoplasmic material. It looks like it looks the same colour, the same stain that goes on. but it's so disrupted, there's the cells which are just being destroyed and again eaten into. I mean, it's fairly active. We've got a full set of these slides which we'll send over to our professors in the University of France for their assessment. But, you know, just looking at it, you can see the halos and the way that the cells are completely disrupted in that respect. And again, I looked through the literature, I can't find anything that does even on humans, but that might just be me. To look at GcMAF alone, GcMAF has been mentioned, has an effect on cells in itself. So we've done some work looking at GcMAF addition on MCF7, and you can see again, we picked a spot where there's a monolayer. It might be too dark to see, but there's a couple of lumps which are above the monolayer. This goes on, this is a 1 minute, one frame a minute, one frame a minute. Cells are beginning to disintegrate into a kind of a monolayer, so they're kind of falling down, if you like, in that way. You see, it's quite obvious now. And then moving on, after 3 days, you can see the difference of the density of the cells and the tightness of the monolayer behind it. So where the cells are less dense, they've obviously moved away, and the actual density around it has changed. So there's a definite sort of morphological change that's observed that we're trying to look into. We're looking at the genomics and proteomics, so we're trying to kind of capture, if you like, cells in the stage of certain stages through the video, and then we're going to send those off to see what proteins have changed pre and post the activity. We're looking to try and develop an ELISA for the GcMAF. We're working with some of the lectins and things like that. And as I mentioned earlier, we're looking at additional carcinoma cell lines. We're going to try prostate because that's obviously quite an important one in the work that we're doing in terms of the cases that are coming through. Whilst we can do cell staining, the actual cellular interaction would be good to try and work out if we can find someone with electron microscopy that we could partner with or collaborate with in that respect. So just to recap, I think we've kind of highlighted to you that GcMAF's tested on a batch-to-batch basis. If it doesn't pass any, just one of those tests, then we don't actually pass it on, so that we don't allow it to be released. We've seen the effect of GcMAF alone on the morphological changes of the human breast carcinoma cell line. You can see that changes quite dramatically. I think we've shown murine macrophages against GcMAF activated on their effect on human breast carcinoma cells, and I think from what I can see is the first human-human interaction as well with activated macrophages. And I think we've also shown that it works, the human macrophages don't just work against one type of cell line, they're actually acting against the second, so I think that's quite pleasing for us. So that's me done, hopefully on time. A bit shorter than a bit rushed, but happy to show anybody the videos on the laptop if they want to at a later date. So, over to you, Dave, is there any questions?
Any questions?
How long would that store GcMAF viable without being, you know,
that
viable? Like,
you
can keep for how long?
Well, we keep it for about a month. We do all our assays in a month, so it's stable with that. We do have some ongoing studies to look for activity. I think 6 weeks is perfectly fine. The new molecules are slightly different because they're more stabilized with oleic acid. I think that helps. So we're at least a month, if not going on to 2 months. But we've got some more molecules to set up in January, which will maybe allow us to do a longer time study.
You did test last year that showed they were 50% active in 8 weeks.
We got up to about 8 weeks. Well, that's it's an activity assay, which is not necessarily in the body.
Stephen.
Yes, Paul. Thank you for your nice view. We saw already a few of these, again, in Frankfurt.
Yeah. so-called activating the GC globulin, and then also vitamin D, we need to do that for the vitamin D, and then nothing at all.
That's probably so.
Thank you very much, Mr.
He did show unactivated macrophages with breast cancer cell lines, and nothing happened. So we do have that control already. We are going to do more controls. But yes, if you don't have the GcMAF there, as that slide showed, absolutely nothing happened.
Very good. Perhaps you told already.
I'd just like to make the point that if you attempt to make GcMAF, you will generally make inactive GcMAF. And unless you put it through tests like this, it's very easy to give people a MAF that just does not work. And in fact, of the seven companies that purport to supply GcMAF, only two have actually made GcMAF that they test and can prove is active. So that may seem like an enormous amount of work, but it is well worth it. And I think now we'll thank Dr. Rod Smith, very much. Is Gail here?
Yes.
Yeah, would you like to come and say a few words? Gail is our first ever stage 4 cancer patient, or I should say was, and she's going to recount her experiences.
Told 3 months later that it had no effect whatsoever.
3 months. I might be lucky, I might need 2 years. I was sent home. I was sent home with an appointment to see a veterinary nurse who was going to prepare me for the inevitable, with no hope for any future. The following week, not believing what I'd been told, I went back to the hospital and said, "Isn't there anything you can do? I still want to live." They said, "You could try tamoxifen." I went home and tried tamoxifen, but within a very short space of time, I was feeling utterly depressed. The only way I can describe how I was feeling was that if somebody had come up to me with a gun, I would have asked them to shoot me. Just please, please shoot me. I went back to the hospital and told them how I was feeling, and they assured me that tamoxifen doesn't make you feel that way, but not to worry, because they would give me antidepressants. I told them I didn't want any antidepressants, I just wanted to feel like I used to. So they asked me just to try it a bit longer, which I did. And then one morning, I was out walking my dogs, and I realized that I was singing and feeling just like I used to. And I realized that I had forgotten to take my drug, just one tablet, just one day. Well, it was by sheer chance that I discovered GcMAF. And from that moment, I never looked back. I injected every day, and there were no side effects, and I was feeling absolutely fantastic, and I was able to continue my work as a landscape gardener. I had a healthy diet, and I always believed you are what you eat, but nevertheless, I modified it to high protein, fish, chicken, vegetables, no carbohydrates. And of course, I was getting plenty of vitamin D from working outside. 3 months later, my scans revealed that my tumor had shrunk to half its size, and that the metastasis in my stomach and my lungs, they had decreased, and then they slightly increased, but they were always smaller. I had gone back to the hospital and asked them if they would remove my tumour, but they told me they felt it was of no benefit to me. I argued my case and they told me that I was aggressive. I told them I didn't know how to be aggressive, but what I did know was I wanted to live. Well, eventually, in April this year, they removed my tumour. And a few months later, they told me I was completely clear. I can't begin to tell you how I felt to know that I've got my life back. And if I may, I would just like to take this opportunity to say such a huge thank you to Lynn and David Noakes, because without them, I wouldn't be here today. Thank you very much.
Yes, Gail's ovarian tumour shrunk to one quarter of its size on GcMAF. She was given 3 months to live, but now, 3 years later, she is as fit as a fiddle. Right, it's now Dr. Zoya Vitenko's presentation. I'm very interested in what she's got to say because I have no idea what it's going to be.
First of all, I'd like to thank you to Immuna Biotech for coming up with this wonderful substance. Well, originally it was developed by somebody, but they are actually making it. And at this point in time, I can't imagine a practice without it. I'm here to present clinical results from multiple patients, multiple treatments. Mostly my practice is a family practice, and I have a lot of people with various conditions who come to me because nobody else can help. And also come to me because they prefer to do things in a more natural way versus, you know, resorting to the biochemical treatments. Before I present, I'd like to talk a little bit about what we're here for. The reason why we have so many patients and the reason we are talking about GcMAF, because we're pretty much into a pandemic of immune disorders. When I was back at school and back at the university, I don't remember seeing so many people who had immune disorders. So cancer is an immune disorder, it's an immune regulation. Different kind of names are coming up lately with different kind of problems, but they're all immune related. So when I apply GcMAF to various immune disorders, I see very good results. That again validates the fact that it is all about the immune system. Now, originally immune system was designed by somebody or evolved into something for the purpose of addressing infections, bacteria, being able to resist the environment and kind of live in a good symphony, in a good balance with the environment. Now what's happening, the bacteria, viruses, parasites, they seem to be taking us over. And the body is not able to resist. So what is affecting the immune system the most, from what I see and what I think, and the question would be more to the immunologist who are present here. I think we're being attacked by the antibiotics. Because what happens is that if you look at the environment, if you look at the skin, it's populated by billions of various microbes. So what happens when you even walk into the pharmacy? So there is a change in the microflora inside and outside. So, and we know that a lot of the like strep stuff, they're kind of present as part of our normal flora, but they take us over when there's an imbalance. So imbalance occurs all the time we're exposed to antibiotics. And antibiotics are coming into us, you know, from the broad spectrum prescriptions. So when nobody tests for culture, unfortunately, that's what the case is in North America. Very rarely we go and do culture and sensitivity prior to providing a prescription. Also it comes from the water, because we breathe a lot. Also it comes from the chicken, beef, milk, everywhere antibiotics are given, we receive that as well. Also it comes from what's happening in the soil and pesticides they use, such as Roundup, where pesticide specifically affects the composition of the bacteria in the soil and also the immune system of the plant. So we're getting that from there as well. So pretty much the immune system is under attack. No wonder that we are facing a pandemic of immune diseases, which is wiping out the population. So going back to GcMAF, GcMAF is something that stimulates the immune system, or regulates, probably a better way of saying it, regulates the immune system. And that's why when people come with fibromyalgia, with